specific purpose. It is within your power to find that proof of purpose has been furnished beyond a reasonable doubt by inferences which may arise from the nature of the acts and the surrounding circumstances. It also makes no difference what the person or persons with whom the defendant actually conspired had in mind, so long as the defendant believed he was furthering the commission of the crime of murder. In summary, the state must prove the following elements. One, with respect to defendant Munoz, that the defendant agreed with another person or persons that they or one or more of them would engage in conduct which constitutes a crime or an attempt or solicitation to commit such crime, and with respect to defendant Velazquez, that the defendant agreed to aid another person or persons in the planning or commission of a crime or of an attempt or solicitation to commit a crime. And with respect to both defendants, that defendant's purpose was to promote or facilitate the commission of the crime of murder. If you find the state has proven each one of these elements beyond a reasonable doubt, then you must find the defendant guilty. If you find the state has failed to prove any of these elements beyond a reasonable doubt, then you must find the defendant not guilty. Each offense and each defendant in this indictment should be considered by you separately. The fact that you may find a particular defendant guilty or not guilty of a particular crime should not control your verdict as to the other offense charged against that defendant, and it should not control your verdict as to the charges against any other defendant. The defendants are charged with the unlawful possession of a handgun in count 4 of the indictment. Count 4 states that on or about the 9th day of November 2015 in the Township of Howell, County of Atlantic, in the jurisdiction of this court, Dennis J. Munoz and Edwin B. Velazquez did knowingly possess a handgun without having obtained a permit to carry same, contrary to law, against the peace of the state, the government, and dignity of the same. The statute upon which this count is based reads in pertinent part as follows. Any person who knowingly has in his possession a handgun without first having obtained a permit to carry the same is guilty of a crime. In order to convict the defendant, the state must prove each of the following elements beyond a reasonable doubt. Number one, it was a handgun. Number two, that the defendant knowingly possessed the handgun. Three, that the defendant did not have a permit to possess such a weapon. The first element, the state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt that there was a handgun. Under our law, a handgun is any pistol, revolver, or other firearm originally designed or manufactured to fire or eject any solid projectile, ball, slug, pellet, missile, or bullet, or any gas, vapor, or other noxious thing by means of a cartridge or shell, or by action of an explosive or the igniting of flammable or explosive substances by the use of a single hand. The second element the state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt is that the defendant knowingly possessed the handgun. To possess an item under the law, one must have a knowing, intentional control of that item accompanied by a knowledge of its character. So, a person who possesses an item, such as a handgun, must know or be aware that he possesses it, and he must know what it is that he possesses or controls, that is, a handgun. Possession cannot merely be a passing control, fleeting or uncertain in its nature. In other words, to possess an item, one must knowingly procure or receive an item or be aware of his control thereof for a sufficient period of time to have been able to relinquish his control if he chose to do so. The state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt that a possessor acted knowingly in possessing the item. A person acts knowingly with the same meaning I gave you earlier when defining murder. A person may possess a handgun even though he was not physically on his person at the time of the arrest, if he had in fact at some time prior to his arrest had control over it. Possession means a conscious, knowing possession, either actual or constructive. Possession may be either actual, constructive, or joint. Actual possession. A person is in actual possession of an item when he first knows what it is, that is, he has knowledge of its character, and second, knowingly has it on his person at a given time. Constructive possession. Possession may be constructive instead of actual. As I just stated, a person who, with knowledge of its character, knowingly has direct physical control over an item at a given time, is in actual possession of it. Constructive possession means possession in which the possessor does not physically have the item on his or her person, but is aware that the item is present and is able to and has the intention to exercise control over it. So someone who has knowledge of the character of an item and knowingly possession may be either sole or joint. If one person alone has actual or constructive possession of an item, possession is sole. If two or more persons share actual or constructive knowing possession of an item, possession is then joint. The third element that the state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt is that each defendant did not have a permit to possess such a handgun. If you find that the defendants knowingly possessed the handgun, and there is no evidence that either defendant had a valid permit to carry such a handgun, then you may infer, if you think it is appropriate to do so based upon the facts presented, that each defendant had no such permit. Note, however, that as with all other elements, the state bears the burden of showing beyond a reasonable doubt the lack of a valid permit, and that you may draw the inference only if you feel it is appropriate to do so under all the facts and circumstances. If you find the state has failed to prove any of the elements of the crime beyond a reasonable doubt, your verdict must be not guilty. On the other hand, if you are satisfied the state has proven each and every element of the crime beyond a reasonable doubt, your verdict must be guilty. Now, the fifth count of the indictment charges the defendants with the crime of possession of a firearm with a purpose to use it unlawfully against the person or property of another. Count 5 reads as follows. On or about the 9th day of November 2015 in the Township of Hamilton, County of Atlantic, and within the jurisdiction of this court, Dennis J. Munoz and Edwin V. Velazquez did knowingly possess a firearm with a purpose to use it unlawfully against the person or property of another, contrary to law, against the peace of the state, the government, dignity of the same. The statute on which this count of the indictment is based reads in pertinent part, any person who has in his possession any firearm with a purpose to use it unlawfully against the person or property of another is guilty of a crime. In order for you to find the defendants guilty of this charge, the state has the burden of proving beyond a reasonable doubt the following four elements of this crime. Number one, there was a firearm. Number two, defendant possessed the firearm. Number three, defendant possessed the firearm with the purpose to use it against the person or property of another. Number four, the defendant's purpose was used to use the firearm unlawfully. The first element the state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt is that there was a firearm. Again, a firearm means any handgun, rifle, shotgun, machine gun, automatic or semi-automatic rifle, or any gun, device, or instrument, and the nature of a weapon from which may be fired or ejected any solid, projectable ball, slug, pellet, missile, or bullet, or any gas, vapor, or other noxious thing by means of a cartridge or shell, or by the action of an explosive or the igniting of flammable or explosive substances. It shall also include, without limitation, any firearm which is in the nature of an air gun, spring gun, or pistol, or any weapon of a similar nature in which the propelling force is a spring, elastic band, carbon dioxide, compressed or other gas or vapor, air or compressed air, or is ignited by compressed air and ejecting the bullet or missile smaller than 3/8 of an inch in diameter with sufficient force to injure a person. The second element the state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt is that the defendants possessed the firearm. Possession has the same meaning I just gave you. The third element the state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt is the defendant's purpose in possessing the firearm was to use it against the person or property of another. Purpose has the same meaning I gave you earlier. The defendant's purpose or conscious objective to use the firearm against another person or the property of another person may be found to exist at any time he is in possession of the object and need not have been the defendant's original intent of possessing the object. The fourth element the state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt is that the defendants had a purpose to use the firearm in a manner that is prohibited by law. I've already defined purpose for you. This element requires that you find the state has proven beyond a reasonable doubt that the defendants possessed a firearm with the conscious objective, design, or specific intent to use it against the person or property of another in an unlawful manner as charged in the indictment, and not for some other purpose. In this case, the state contends that the defendant's unlawful purpose in possessing the firearm was the murder or serious bodily injury of Michael Black. You must not rely upon your own notions of the unlawfulness of some other undescribed purpose of the defendant. Rather, you must consider whether the state has proven the specific unlawful purpose charged. The unlawful purpose alleged by the state may be inferred from all that was said or done, from all of the surrounding circumstances of the case. However, the state need not prove defendant accomplished his unlawful purpose of using the firearm. If you are satisfied beyond a reasonable doubt that the state has proven each of the elements of this offense as I defined them, then you must find the defendant's guilty. However, if you find the state has failed to prove beyond a reasonable doubt any of the elements, then you must find the defendant not guilty. Count 6 of the indictment charges defendant Munoz with tampering with witnesses in violation of a statute that reads as follows. Tampering. A person commits an offense if, believing that an official proceeding or investigation is pending or about to be instituted or has been instituted, he he knowingly engages in conduct which a reasonable person would believe would cause a witness to testify or inform falsely. In order for you to find the defendant guilty of violating this statute, the state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt each and every one of the following elements. One, that the defendant believed that an official proceeding or investigation was pending or about to be instituted or has been instituted. And two, that the defendant knowingly engaged in conduct which a reasonable person would believe would cause a witness or informant to testify or inform falsely. First element the state must prove beyond reasonable doubt is that the defendant believed that an official proceeding or investigation was pending or about to be instituted or had been instituted. This means that the state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt that the defendant knew of an official proceeding or that an investigation was pending or that an investigation had been instituted or was aware of facts that would lead a reasonable person to believe that an official action was pending or about to be instituted or had been instituted. Official proceeding is defined as proceeding heard, or which may be heard before any legislative, judicial, administrative, or other governmental agency or official authorized to take evidence under oath, including any referee, hearing examiner, commissioner, notary, or other person taking testimony or deposition in connection with any such proceeding. The second element the state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt is that defendant knowingly engaged in conduct that a reasonable person would believe would cause a witness to testify or inform falsely. A person acts knowingly with the same meaning I gave you earlier. If the state has failed to prove any one or more of these elements as I've described them to you beyond a reasonable doubt, you must find the defendant not guilty of tampering with a witness. If the state has proven every element beyond a reasonable doubt, you must find the defendant guilty of the crime of tampering with a witness. Now, our statutes provide that tampering with a witness is a crime of the second degree if the actor employed force or the threat of force. It is a crime of the first degree if the actor employed force or the threat of force and the conduct occurred during an official proceeding or investigation involving a crime enumerated in a portion of our statutes codified at New Jersey Statutes 2C:43-7.2. If you find the state has proven the defendant guilty beyond a reasonable doubt of tampering with a witness, then you must determine whether or not the state has proven beyond a reasonable doubt that the defendant employed force or threat of force. Force means any degree of physical power or strength used against another person, even though it entails no pain or bodily harm and leaves no mark. Threat of force means that the words or actions of the defendant must be of such a nature as to convey menace or fear of force to the ordinary person. The state contends that the defendant threatened the use of force both implicitly and explicitly to Heather Wickliffe, Keith Wickliffe, and Courtney Chiaretto by written and oral communications. If you find the state has proven the defendant guilty beyond a reasonable doubt of tampering with the witness and that he employed force or the threat of force, then you must find him guilty of tampering with the witness in the second degree. You must then determine whether or not the state has proven beyond a reasonable doubt that the defendant's conduct occurred in connection with an official proceeding or investigation involving the crimes enumerated in a portion of our statutes at 2C:43-7.2. The state contends that defendant's conduct occurred in connection with an official proceeding or investigation involving the crime of murder. I've already defined official proceeding for you earlier. Under the law of New Jersey, murder is a crime enumerated under 2C:43-7.2. If you find the state has proven beyond a reasonable doubt the defendant is guilty of tampering with a witness and employed force or the threat of force, then you must find him guilty of tampering with a witness in the second degree. On the other hand, you find the state has failed to prove beyond a reasonable doubt the defendant employed force or the threat of force, then you must find him not guilty of tampering with a witness in the second degree. If, however, you find the defendant is guilty of tampering with a witness and that he employed force or the threat of force, and the state has proven beyond a reasonable doubt the defendant's conduct occurred in connection with an official proceeding or investigation involving the enumerated crime alleged, you must find him guilty of tampering with a witness in the first degree. If, however, you find the state has not proven beyond a reasonable doubt that the actor employed force or the threat of force and conduct occurred in connection with an official proceeding or investigation involving a crime enumerated under 2C:43-7.2, then you must find him not guilty of tampering with a witness in the first degree. counsel wish to be heard on the court's substantive charge? I'm aware of the typographical error that has to be corrected on page 17. Nothing from Velazquez or Munoz?
No, Your Honor.
For the state?
Did I believe there's a typo on page 12?
Okay, good point. We'll change the copies for the
yes, judge. Thank you.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, I'll now give you some information on the final part of these instructions on conducting their deliberations. There is nothing different in the way the jury is to consider the proof in a criminal case from that in which all reasonable persons treat any questions depending upon evidence presented to them. You are expected to use your own good common sense. Consider the evidence for only those purposes for which it has been admitted and give it a reasonable and fair construction in the light of your knowledge of how people behave. It is the quality of the evidence, not simply the number of witnesses that control. Now, as I've said before, any exhibit that has not been marked into evidence cannot be given to you in the jury room, even though it may have been marked for identification and handled in court. Only those items marked in evidence can be given to you, with the following exception. Any audio or video recording, if you wish to see or review it, please let us know that. You can come back in the court and we'll play it for you in court so you can see and hear it. So any of the audio recordings, any of the video recordings will have to be played for you in court. You won't have, you know, a TV or a tape recorder back there with you. So if you want to see it, just send me a note. Now, very shortly, you'll go into the jury room to start your deliberations. I remind you that during deliberations, and in fact, at any time you're in the deliberation room, you have to keep your cell phones and other devices off. You're to apply the laws I've instructed you to the facts as you find them to be for the purpose of arriving at a fair and correct verdict. Verdict must represent the considered judgment of each juror and must be unanimous as to each charge. This means that all of you must agree if the defendant is guilty or not guilty on each charge. It is your duty as jurors to consult with one another and to deliberate with a view toward reaching an agreement if you can do so without violence to your individual judgment. Each of you must decide the case for yourself, but do so only after an impartial consideration of the evidence with your fellow jurors. In the course of your deliberations, do not hesitate to re-examine your own views and change your opinion if convinced it is erroneous, but do not surrender your honest conviction as to the weight or effect of evidence solely because of the opinion of your fellow jurors or for the mere purpose of returning a verdict. You're not partisans, you're judges of the facts. Now, you may return on each crime, charge, or verdict either not guilty or guilty. Your verdict, whatever it may be, as to each crime charge, must be unanimous. That is, each of the 12 members of the deliberating jury must agree as to the verdict. Now, to assist you in reporting your verdict, I've prepared verdict sheets for you. You'll have these with you in the jury room. These verdict forms are not evidence. They're forms only to be used to report your verdict. There'll be one for each defendant. As to defendant Munoz, you'll see that there's count one, murder, and then there's a not guilty or guilty to check. And then if you should find the defendant guilty, then there's the additional question about his own conduct. You answer that yes or no. Count two is conspiracy. Your choices are not guilty or guilty. As to count four, unlawful possession of a weapon without a permit, your choices are not guilty or guilty. As to count five, possession on lawful purpose, your choices are not guilty or guilty. And as to count six, witness tampering, basic charge of witness tampering is set forth as I just explained it to you, and you find either guilty or not guilty. If you find not guilty, then you're done. If you find guilty, then you have to answer the additional questions about force or the threat of force. And if so, if you find that to have happened, that it was true, then you answer the question as to whether or not it happened in connection with an investigation or charging with respect to murder. As to defendant Munoz, Velazquez, you'll see count two, conspiracy to commit murder. Choices are not guilty or guilty. As to count three, murder as an accomplice, as I define that for you, choices are not guilty or guilty. Count four, unlawful possession of a weapon without a permit. Choices are not guilty or guilty. And as to count five, possession for an unlawful purpose, choices are not guilty or guilty. Now, I'm not suggesting that you will or you should, but if during your deliberations you have a question or feel that you need further assistance or instructions from me or wish to have certain testimony read or played back to you or again for a video or audio exhibit to be played back, write your question or request on a sheet of paper give it to the officers who will be standing by the jury room door, and they in turn will give it to me. Now, the court officers will be sworn to perform certain duties, such as keeping you together in a private place for your deliberations and to ensure that nobody else speaks to you except upon my order. You're not to discuss with or ask the officer about trial matters or procedures. Please be aware they're instructed not to communicate with you and to enter the room only with your consent, except to communicate on my behalf such administrative matters about breaks or meals, or otherwise ensure your comfort. Now, once the officers enter the room, they'll knock first. Please stop your deliberations and don't resume them until the officer leaves the room. Now, once I have your question or request, I'll go over it with the lawyers and try to answer it as quickly as possible. I ask for your continued patience. If you send out a question, please don't disclose where you stand on your deliberations. Don't say we're 8-4 or 10-2 or something like that on any particular charge. Just ask the